Penguin Random House Audio presents An American Immigrant, a novel by Johanna Rojas Vann. Read for you by Allison Strong. To my mother, thank you for your sacrifice. My life is sweeter because of it. Prologue, June 2009, Cali, Colombia. Anita. She clutched the leather duffel bag on her lap. The flight attendant walked by and asked if she could store the bag for Anita in the overhead compartment. Anita shook her head. She wanted to make sure the contents inside didn't get flattened or crushed on the long flight home. From the exterior slip pocket, she pulled out a journal and brushed the front cover with her hand. Spreading it open over the creases of the bag, Anita continued transferring memories from her head onto the page. Since arriving at the airport early that morning, she'd hardly let her pen rest. She made this trip yearly, but it was the first time she'd had to travel with a few treasured possessions to store in her mother's home. With the divorce, she'd decided life in a new state would be the fresh start she and her three kids needed. But their new apartment lacked the space to store anything beyond necessities. Her mother's home was the only place she felt her things would be safe. When she finally stepped foot through her mother's door after the long journey, she took a deep breath. Since moving to America, returning to her childhood home had become the breath of fresh air she waited for each year. Alba peeked her head into the front hallway, and when she saw her daughter standing beneath her doorway, luggage in tow, she scrambled toward her with arms wide open. "Hola, mi amor," Alba whispered, arms around her neck. Anita's shoulders relaxed beneath her mother's embrace. Alba stepped back and looked her daughter up and down. "You look skinny. Come, let's eat. I have plenty."
"Of course you do."
Anita smiled and followed her mother into the kitchen, where she was met with the familiar aroma of strong coffee and sweet bread.
"I wish you would have brought the kids with you. They're getting so big. I'm afraid I won't recognize them the next time I see them," Alba said.
"If only I could convince them. They're not interested in coming here, Mama. I asked if they'd like to come, but every one of them had something they just couldn't miss," Anita said, using air quotes. "Some camp, some birthday outing for a friend. Who knows? Their dad is staying with them while I'm here."
Alba shrugged.
"Well, hopefully the next time you come, they'll want to tag along. Or you could just tell them they have to come with you."
Anita shook her head.
"I don't know, Mama. I don't want to force them to come. I want them to want to come here. It's not you, Mama. They miss you, of course, but it's like they can't stand the idea of leaving the States. They think that's all there is to see in the world."
She took a sip of coffee and stared into the mug.
"I hope I didn't make a mistake raising them there."
Alba reached out her hand and grabbed Anita's wrist, gently massaging it.
"I just want them to be proud of who we are,"
Anita said, looking into her mother's eyes.
"They're still so young. Don't worry about all that. Just keep speaking to them in Spanish and talking about our culture. They don't have to grow up in this country to learn those things and be proud Colombians."
"But what if that's not enough? They stumble on their words when they speak Spanish, and so they revert to English. They're more comfortable in English. I try to force them to speak to me in Spanish, but it just aggravates them. Alex doesn't even know what these are," Anita said,
raising a pan de bono from her plate.
"I'm not doing enough, Mama. I'm failing them."
"Todo en su tiempo, mi amor."
"Everything in its time, my love. You're not failing. You're a wonderful mother. Have faith and do your best. There's not much else you can do."
Alba dusted her hands on her apron and stood. "Now finish up so you can get some rest." When the round wooden table in her mother's dining room was cleared, Anita gathered her belongings from the front of the house and took them to the very back, where her old bedroom was. Alba hadn't changed a single thing since her daughters left. She dropped onto the bed she once shared with her two sisters. One look around brought back fond memories of staying up late braiding one another's hair and gossiping about the boys in school. She let out a deep sigh. Never once did she imagine the three of them would be scattered around the Northeast in America, raising their kids hours apart from one another. She lifted the leather tote from the ground, placed it on her lap, and peeked inside.
I won't leave you here forever. Just until I can afford to get us a bigger place.
She walked to the closet and wiped the dust from the shelf inside with the washcloth her mother had left on her bed. Then she closed the leather bag with the gold-plated clasp and stuffed it as far back on the shelf as she could, hoping it would be safely hidden there. Back on her bed, scooted against the headboard, she opened the journal she'd been writing in at the airport, her pen still stuffed inside. It had been years since she'd written, but the journal still had a few empty pages to fill. There was a large gap of time and events missing from this journal, but perhaps with a little more dedication, she could fill in those holes with all that had happened since the day she left this home. And what better place to document those memories than where it all began? Part 1. Chapter 1. 2018, Miami. Melanie.
It's still warm.
Melanie whispered as she brushed a copy of the Miami Herald across her cheek.
What are you doing?
She jumped and turned around to find Rick, the overnight security guard, sitting up from behind the receptionist's desk.
Rick, you scared me. What are you doing kicked back on Amanda's desk?
Melanie folded the newspaper and tucked it underneath her arm. She'll be in any minute, and I do not want to know what she'd do to you if she saw your grungy boots near her Chinese money plant. Rick kicked his feet off the desk and meandered across the lobby to a less comfortable post.
She doesn't scare me. So, do you always sniff newspapers when you think no one's looking?
Do you always take naps at Amanda's desk when you're on the clock?
Touché.
I won't tell Amanda what I witnessed if we never speak of this again,
Melanie said with a wink. She reached for her badge, which she kept attached to the belt loop of her pants at all times. The day HR handed her this badge was the day she became the first to arrive and the last to leave the newsroom each day. It was her first year on the job, and she had a lot to prove. This year especially would be crucial to her future success.
There's no way she'd allow another rookie reporter to outperform her.
Deal.
When she opened the door, a gust of air from the frigid newsroom tousled her cola-colored pin-straight hair, the perfect accessory for a confident strut to her desk.
Could this morning get any better?
She wore her favorite pair of black twill pants, the one she'd bought at the J.Crew factory the day she signed her offer letter, and had even splurged on a vanilla latte from Starbucks. The occasion warranted a fancy coffee drink, despite her having a slim $35 in her bank account. It didn't matter. Not when this was the morning she'd been waiting for. All her hard work had paid off, and now it was time for the best part, to see her byline closer to the front page of the Herald. Her articles, usually local stories no one else wanted to cover, were often published somewhere between pages 10 and 14. But not today. She'd overheard the page editors discussing placing her article closer to the front because of the big interview she'd landed with the Attorney General. When Melanie reached her desk, she laid out the crisp newspaper on top. She smoothed out the front and slowly flipped through the various pages. Every part of her wanted to find her name as quickly as possible. But she knew better than to turn the pages with too much force. Melanie loved the way a newspaper felt in her hands, the gentle weight of it, the crinkling sound that reminded her to be careful, the way it bent to the rhythm of her fingers. Opening a fresh copy each morning was like a meditative practice that never got old. Only, suddenly, she felt pulled away from this calming ritual. She'd come to the middle of the newspaper and hadn't found her article. She furrowed her eyebrows and tilted her head.
Maybe it's a little deeper in.
She turned a few more pages. After another skim, she still came up empty.
Maybe I missed it. I must be so excited I'm missing it right before my eyes.
Okay. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.